The interesting thing has been that while Africa has developed this, what you call several institutions, it has been very difficult to get the African institutions to function properly. We have human rights organizations which do not report any kind of abuse by the current government. We have the police, which in most cases are part and parcel of the crime-making process in this continent. We have the Office of the Ombudsman, which is supposed to take hearings on the abuse by courts and the abuse by institutions of the government. But it's very difficult to show that the institutions are functional. And if these institutions are functional, the MDGs that were given to us by the United Nations would not be implemented properly, because the serious problems associated with the implementation of this MDGs is not just having students in school, like primary school enrollment becomes 100% in this country today. But if you go deep under the skin, how many people do finish primary school? It's a very difficult task. In fact, the majority don't finish primary school. You talk about girls' education, we have 100% enrollment for girls' education. But how many of them do finish primary school? And in the other problems you have is the tertiary education in different countries. So the problems that are associated with all these issues that you raise in the MDGs are not just a question of the MDGs. They are related to the deeper issue of creating a multilateral society, a plural society that would eventually bring in the kind of development we wish that all of us would like to have. I lost my file. That's what I'm looking for here while I'm talking. So the idea of having to achieve Millennium Development Goals is strictly related to the possibility of African governments creating institutions that are responsible and accountable to the population. When we talk about accountability and creating a plural society, as you've seen in the last 20 years or so after the fall of the Soviet Union, we had this idea of elections coming up. We had several elections in Africa which are very successful. But how many countries have passed what you call the two-turnover test? The two-turnover test is where you had military or colonial governments and were replaced by a civilian government with a political party that was elected into office. Have the opposition been able to win office from a civilian government? So it's a transformation from one civilian government to another civilian government. Mali had gone through this process. Opposition groups had won elections. But eventually, what did you see in Mali? The military intervened. The Tuaregs came in from the north. The French came with their weapons. So Mali now is in a direction that we don't even know. So essentially, even the two-turnover test is not going to guarantee the kind of democracy that we're going to look into this continent. And unless citizens have a ways of concerning getting their voice to be heard, then in the end what the problem is going to be is that people cannot participate in the process of national development. So everything that the MDGs would give us in terms of what would be needed to done to get Africa out of illiteracy, out of ill health, out of all the problems that we always mention, the problem becomes one big problem of governance and public administration. Let's look at the public administration of some of the countries in Africa. Somalia, for example, didn't have a government for 20 years. The Central African Republic hardly had a government of its own. In DRC, you have 10 diamond mines, and 9 of them are not even known by the government. Nobody pays taxes. The diamond is taken from airfields of their own. These people have their own air force, they have their own armies. And as far as 2009, when I was there doing a regional action plan for the DRC, the problem has been that this country will never be able to get out of poverty and penury, when of course DRC it has the potential to produce $24 trillion economy. That's been calculated very well by the African Development Bank, by the World Bank. It has gold, diamond, coltan, it has timber, it's rich in resources. The Inga Dam alone, if it's completed, once it's constructed, will generate 40,000 megawatts of electricity, which currently is probably the consumption of the entire sub-Saharan Africa. So we're talking about the MDGs that are going to be implemented in a narrow arena where you don't even have the basic necessities of life. In a country where you have most people that are hungry, in a country where you have nutrition as a big problem, building infrastructure, cities, and roads, and railways, and bridges, doesn't mean anything in terms of human development. And the MDGs are focused on human development, specifically to bring in the kind of development that humans need. These are education, good health, and longer life. But this is not the kind of promise we have in this continent. So we have to be critical in assessing the MDGs. Everybody is saying, you know, okay, we're going to have to achieve the MDGs. Ethiopia has achieved already 7 of the MDGs out of the 8. Maternal mortality in this country becomes a serious problem because it's associated with some cultures like the pastoralists who wouldn't allow their wives to see even a doctor, to go to a clinic. The pastoralists have their own traditional mechanisms. Early marriage in northern part of Ethiopia, where girls are married at the age of 10, at the age of 8, and their physical and physiological capacity to bear children is not even there. So they die with their children when they are pregnant. And this is an epidemic. It's not just a problem that is isolated. So we're talking about the MDGs when we're talking about problems that are fundamentally associated with culture and with religious rights. So I think the most important issue that we need to talk in terms of the African development is that we should be able to talk about how we're going to manage African development when we cannot even change simple issues like the ability of African states to be able to bring a certain level of peace and integrity to the society. In this, let me try to find what I'm trying to talk about and then we'll continue. The idea of the Millennium Development Goals emanated from a long frustration. We had had several kinds of declarations on Africa. And in these declarations, we've seen that Africa could develop. We had the African Transformation Act. We had the World Bank $25 billion initiative in the 1980s. We had the new NEPAD, which frankly has literally done nothing, except we had a fight between the NEPAD Secretariat, which is situated in South Africa, and the AU Commission here. I think there is some kind of now a change of heart where NEPAD is going to be a commission under the African Union here. So these are issues that we really need to raise and speak about if we're going to see the structural transformation of this continent. So the challenge that we have in African transformation can be set up within three arenas. One is the global arena, the second one is the continental arena, and the third one is the national arena. The global arena is something that has been very important because we've talked about, for example, debt reduction in Africa by the developed nations. They cleaned up African debt. Nigeria, it got cleaned up, $34 billion of debt was gone from Nigeria. From Ethiopia, I think $4.5 billion was gone. But what has been made different since then? It's very difficult to find the evidence that this debt reduction has contributed to national development, that the money that has been reduced by the debt has been used, for example, for human development issues such as health and education. But the problem with African governments is that they have become very smart now in terms of presenting their issues to the world. So they have people who are very smart, consultants like myself, who go and write very good reports for them, that they have achieved the MDGs, that they have achieved girls' education, when frankly we don't have any reference point on how the global society can check on this. We're talking about African growth now, and my next book that's coming out probably in 2 weeks is the same title here, Unleashing the African Resilience. And the evidence for the states to be able to use the resources that have been released from debt servicing and the resources that are coming in as foreign aid are not simply used very well. And this is the evidence you see is the greedy leaders that we have always used this, the funds to keep themselves in power, to keep their political parties in power. So as long as we have that kind of incentive within the government and cannot create a pluralist society, then the problem becomes the issue of poverty cannot be in any way be redirected in terms of how we can save this continent. In another instance, we say that Africa has been growing very much, but where has this growing gone? Where has this material benefits accrued to? Ethiopia has been growing at 11% and 10% for the last decade. This is phenomenal. The United States is growing at 1%. China is growing at 8%, 9%. But Equatorial Guinea has been growing at 15%. But how do you relate this economic growth with the actual life of ordinary human beings? Why do we have 5 million people who are on food aid? Why do we have 7.5 million families on safety nets? Why do we have programs like the protection of basic services? So governments rarely go back and look into this and say, okay, Ethiopia, for example, has 72 million hectares of arable land. It's the water tower of East Africa. Ethiopia is exporting water in all four directions, including the Nile. And then we're only using 10% of that land. And yet, Ethiopia's name is synonymous with famine. And no government has tried to look out into the possibility of changing this image from a famine image into an image of prosperity. Technically, Ethiopia used to be called the breadbasket of Africa when USAID started what you call the Point Four program under President Truman. So the point I'm trying to say is we have the resources, but the problems and the challenge we have are very, very difficult. Let's see, for example, the UNECA, African Union, and the ECOSOC report says that poverty rates in Africa have dropped below 50%. God knows what amount they were before. They went down to 50%. If you have 50% of the population that's poor, then you have a problem, serious problem. We studied 110 military coup d'etats and counter coup d'etats in Africa. All 110 of them, to summarize for you in three sentences, the first reason is people are not happy with the government because of structural adjustments or because of military rule or because of whatever, then they are disgruntled. The second thing is you have a military that is the most opportunistic organization in society. When the military sees an opportunity, they step in. That's what has happened in Egypt now. That's how what happened in Mali. And in Central African Republic, they use religion as a pretext for the armed gangs to come in and take over power. So the military says people don't like it. So when the military takes power, civil society rises up, they go on demonstration, they say, good news, the military is going to do a good thing. The third thing is the military that makes the coup are the closest people to the government, probably palace guards most of the time, and they become much worse than the previous government. So this is exactly what the cycle that we're going to go through. We published this in the Journal of African Lawyers Union. I published the document there. And military coups are going to be again in style in this continent. Employment is a pathway to exit poverty. But what has been the success of employment in Africa. Since 2008, it has been on the rise, but employment has never matched the population growth and the youth that are leaving the schools. Absence of functional social protection system. These are issues that have become very pertinent to Africa. If you see on the slide there, the amount of people living under $1.25 is amazing. We have only four or five countries that have exited from this. We have Cote d'Ivoire, Kenya, Madagascar, Nigeria, and Morocco. Then you start Mozambique, Ethiopia, and others. We're still in the minus stage. So it's important to look into the macro aspects, how we can do this. So sustaining progress in poverty reduction require increasing the pace and inclusiveness of the growth process, as well as investment in social service and infrastructure. This is an important statement to make, because in the next slide, we're going to look into how we're going to go to achieve this. What are the policy options to achieve national development vision and aspirations? The first is a process of continuous educational and technological innovation, industrial upgrade and diversification, and improvements in the various types of infrastructure and institutional arrangements that constitute the context for business development and wealth creation. This is an important statement, because governments must decide that their government should be able to facilitate a process in which everybody can be lifted out of poverty. China has lifted 500 million people out of poverty in just 3 years. This is very important. And the world we live in, by the way, in comparison to what it was probably 20 years ago, is much better if you see the global figures, the amount of people. Just because of China lifting 500 million people out of poverty, the statistics for the world has changed dramatically. But how does China do it? It's not a democratic country. It's a communist country, dominated by the communists and the military. But they brought in an important issue in development. Their version of the developmental state is business from the United States, like Apple, like Microsoft, like IBM, are not just bringing money, but they're bringing money, technology, and management know-how into China. That's why they're succeeding. In Africa, if you're going to have that kind of foreign direct investment, the least we can do is at least have some kind of an industrial peace where foreign investors can work in. As we talk, South Africa, for example, 70,000 miners are going to be on strike, and the platinum mines will be closed. And this platinum is technically dominated by South Africa in this world. So the price of platinum will go up, and the income from platinum for South Africa will go down. So the point is, are we able to have that kind of industrial peace if investors are going to come in? Investors also go into a country to invest, supposing that there is one, cheap labor and very lax labor laws, number two, very lax environmental laws. These are what makes production more expensive in Europe and in North America, in Asia, in probably Japan too. But you go to China, I mean, now Beijing, last week I was passing through Beijing, and they said it had been polluted to 20 times what was allowed by the WHO in terms of pollution. So these are, when we talk about fast growth in the tiger economies of South Korea and others, there has been some serious energy that has been paid on this, human energy, human life. So how do we do it differently in Africa? What kind of states do we create so that this status would be able to do this? Front-loading policies and resources for achieving human development and human security. I think these are very prominent issues. There is always an argument in African countries where you want to build a railway, you want to build a road, you want to build a waterway, you want to build a dam for energy production. But if we see the story of development in Europe and North America, it's the different way. In Australia, prisoners from UK, prisoners are the ones who went to Australia to develop it. The first thing they developed was the human capital, the ability of human beings to be able to survive, to educate themselves, to be aware of their environment and trying to change it. Then, you know, the resources in terms of roads and railways will come later on. But in Africa, we're trying to do it the other way. World Bank gives you money, $1 billion, you build a road or a bridge or something, and in the road that's supposed to carry 10,000 vehicles per day, you don't even see 10 camels or 10 donkeys going on it. And 5 years down the road, you're going to start repairing it. So the point is, we've not focused on human development. And the base for human development is human security, a life free of menace, violence against women, violence against children, violence against civilian populations are almost accepted culturally in many cultures. I went to Darfur, this is a story I heard. I mean, where women were raped in front of their families, where, I mean, to humiliate the entire family. And rape is not just a question of having a good time for men who are invading a community. It's about changing the demography of the village. It's to change the nature of the genetic composition of that village by the invading tribe. So I think these are the paramount things that African states have to be able to do, it, and they can do it, frankly. Why do we respect President Mandela? Because he served for 4 years and he said, I don't want another term. Because he created an industrial peace within which industry could function. Because he said the economy should go on if we're going to have all South Africans to be lifted up. Otherwise, today South Africa, if he said, you know, we don't want the whites, although they are fourth generation there, let them go home, you know what South Africa would have been. It would have been another Somalia or probably Chad or Mali or Central African Republic. That's why we call him a great man. Otherwise, what are the benefits that accrue to the blacks in South Africa? There are lots of questions that one needs to answer on that issue. Integrating culture in the development agenda is an important issue that comes as a recommendation. I have sent this presentation and the paper I wrote to the organizers, so I'm sure they'll share it with you. Education and Inclusive Knowledge Society for Sustainable Development. This is an important issue that's been globally now being talked about. When we talk about education, it's not the classroom education that brings people from grade 1 to grade 2, grade 5, grade 6, and then tertiary education. We're talking about education that creates critical thinking on people to know their environment and to see how they belong into that environment and how they can change that environment positively. Gender equality and women's economic empowerment is very sad. In Africa, gender equality issue has become an issue for workshops. It has become an agenda for, you know, political speech. But in principle, how many African countries do have gender-sensitive budgets? When we talk about a gender-sensitive budget, to give you an example, is when you build a clinic, if you have antenatal clinics for pregnant women, if you have maternal child health clinics for women and children, if you have minor surgery, for example, for a cesarean section, of which many women die during childbirth, then it becomes a gender-sensitive budget because your budget defines what the government is going to do at the end of the day. I think we need to open one of the windows. This is turning into some kind of a sauna. I think they have locked it. That one is open. Civil society policies, civic rights, and civic engagement. This is another area that is very important for national development. Many countries now are bringing in civil society policies that actually deter civil society from participating in the political and in the development arena. You might have heard the celebrated case of Ethiopia where civil society, the civil society proclamation that came in 2009 prohibits Ethiopian civil society organizations from receiving funds from abroad for democratic work if they're raising their money more than 10%. They cannot spend more than 30% of their money for their overheads, and what constitutes overheads is the 30% is like teacher's salary is an overhead. A program coordinator's salary is an overhead. So supposing you're trying to build a school where the school becomes an overhead, teacher salary becomes an overhead, then how are you going to function? So there are these kind of subtle laws that are coming because most of our leaders in Africa today were either guerrillas or civil society watchdogs themselves. But once they leave their guerrilla position and become states, then they act completely against the objectives that they came in. A meritorious and politically neutral civil service. You've heard all about the Indian civil service. It's independent, it serves any government that's in power. And of course, entry into the Indian civil service is very, very difficult. We come to Africa, in Egypt, the civil service system had about 5 million employees. All of them are given jobs to keep their mouths shut, to have the benefits of government salaries and privileges and prerogatives. In most of African countries today, once a government is there, I mean, look at Angola with a $200 billion chest over the last 10 years, there is nothing to show for it in terms of national development. And yet, the daughter of the Angolan president has gone to Portugal to buy the Portuguese telecom. So, in effect, you know, these are the issues that we need to look into very seriously when we're looking into a meritorious and politically neutral civil service. Credit and capital markets. You know, every African government, you open a new aid office like the Millennium Challenge Corporation in the United States, head of states go all the way to Washington, D.C. to go and beg money. When we can create credit and capital markets that would infuse the private sector with the necessary credit, and eventually the private sector would also, through the profits, would infuse the capital markets. This is the only way capitalism can work. Otherwise, we have to invent a new model outside capitalism and socialism that would be functional in Africa, full of partial liberalization of units. Most countries still control their banks, they still control their financial institutions, they still control their airlines, shipping lines, ports. Is this a job for the state? Initially, when we started, we said a good job for the state is a good regulatory organ. What happened in the United States in 2008 in terms of the financial crisis is the United States government forgot its regulatory mandates and left the banks to do whatever they want to do. So, in effect, it became a welfare state when it was bailing out the banks. So, in essence, we need to sit down case by case and see what kind of radical change to global governance institutions we can bring. Because one of the problems we have with African countries is they always have a patron, you know. France is a patron, and I don't know if you've seen this Al Jazeera movie, Francafrique. How many of you have seen it? Francafrique. You've seen it. You've seen how France has been making coup d'etats in Africa, counter coups, how business deals have been done without even the government knowing with guerrilla leaders, how governments have been removed from power simply because these governments didn't want to. In fact, François Mitterrand at one time said France without Africa would be a third world country. So when we say global governance, it is how ex-colonial institutions, the World Bank, the African Development Bank, the IMF would function. I saw a draft charter that is going to US Congress, where US Congress is demanding a law to preclude Ethiopia from development assistance because it's relocating people where it's building dams. And it says very clearly, we have to tell the IMF and the World Bank to stop funding Ethiopia. So the American government now has a very serious clout on Ethiopia's development. I mean, if you're building dams, then you have to remove people from dams. They've done that when they built the Hoover Dam in the United States. They've done that in Europe. Because when it comes to Africa, because you're removing 300,000 people 5 kilometers away where the dam is going to hold water, then you have a problem. So global governance institutions, there is not even dialogue. They just impose things on you. So I have given a series of issues on how to reform the global governance institutions, which I'm sure most of you are aware of in your career. It talks about fair trade, global governance, fighting corruption and everything. Well, the world has become a better place now. Human development and human security have improved at an unprecedented rate and scale. But as I said, this, some countries like the BRIC countries have changed, transformed themselves in the last 5 years. Brazil has done a lot. China has done a lot. India has done a lot. Russia has done a lot. And some countries in Africa, such as Ghana, have done a lot. And with the democratization process in Ghana, what has happened is, of course, they have found now oil resources. They have developed their human resources very well. Mauritius is another country that can be. So Africa should join this club of nations that have effectively transformed themselves. And when we talk about human security is rising, women's and children's rights and the UN Declaration on the Right to Protect have come. There are improvements, but these improvements have not come at a time when we could improve them to a point where they can make change. And in Africa, it's always late, you know, before you do anything. In Rwanda, the international community had to wait until 1 million people were slaughtered to intervene. And frankly, the UN, nobody intervened at that time, except that President Kagame went in with his guerrilla army and saved whatever was left of the Tutsis. In Somalia, what do we see? It's just wait and see. And frankly, there is even a fight between Italy, the European Union, and the UN in that, because Italy says, this is my old colony, I have to deal with Somalia, nobody should interfere in this. It's like they have a certificate to control Somalia all their life, you know? The European Union tried to recognize Somaliland, which is a very peaceful place, and which had an election where the opposition won with 50,000 votes and became a government, and it cannot be recognized because Italy is saying Somaliland was part of Somalia, and Somalia was my colony, so we cannot have any debate on this. So you have a kind of a veto on this. So the global governance institutions are very important for our national development. Well, finally, what's the role of the state in national development and democratization? The role of the state in achieving rapid and sustained economic development combined with deep structural transformation must be channeled through a disciplined policy planning approach. Democracy is a process of institutional learning. We cannot have a prescription for democracy. You go to the United States, you have two political parties, either the Democrats or the Republicans win. If you are a communist, they'll kill you. They'll kill you, and they have several ways of killing you. You go to Europe, you have social democrats, Christian democrats that came after World War II, and now you have anti-immigration parties. They don't want to see Africans, Asians, Muslims to go into Europe anymore. And frankly, these are the people who are providing the services in that continent. But anti-immigration has become, all of a sudden, immigration is a problem, so anti-immigration becomes a major political agenda. So, political leadership requires intimate knowledge of public policy analysis, formulation, and management. This is the dilemma of democracy. An imam or a priest who is very popular in a community during elections wants to be elected. Everybody trusts this imam or priest because he has done or she has done a wonderful thing in society. But that imam or priest doesn't have public policy knowledge. They don't know how to formulate policies and legislative acts. So they go and find themselves in parliament stuck with identifying and endorsing, rubber stamping, whatever the brilliant prime minister or president brings in. Investment in research and focused industrial and social policy. These are another area where African countries lack. In South Africa, we have more than 400 policy think tanks. But frankly, where is the impact of these policy think tanks? Do they have a channel where policy can be influenced by the kind of research they're undertaking? The policy, the research policy and the implementation nexus. So that becomes another difficult arena. Finally, mainstreaming developmentalism requires a whole gadget of studies. And it's not to say that we're short of studies in Africa. If you go to any government office in Addis Ababa or the African Union, you will find probably miles and miles of documents that have been studied by consultants. But these studies have never been read in the first place. And if they were read, they have never been understood. And if they've been understood, there has never been any resource to implement them. So donors are left to do whatever they want to do, to impose the kind of development that they want to impose. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'll be ready to answer.
Say, Prof has given us hope and also a lot of disaster because I can feel the extent to which leadership in Africa has created quite so many pitfalls and that. In fact, I am beginning to think or to conclude that what we must get right is this leadership thing. You see, the yes, we'll feed the records, achieve MDG, 50%, 60, all that talk. But when he raised the issue of, yes, we've been able to reduce the distance of kids going to school, we've been able to provide the classrooms, but then in the final analysis, how many of these kids get out of school, how many of that? And I think, to me, this is quite a deep poser. Prof, I'm still assimilating what you have said, and I think I will comment much later. It's quite thought provoking. Thank you.
Rafael from Nigeria. Thank you very much, Prof, for the very inspiring presentation. Very interested in those challenges that African countries face that you've rightly identified. But unfortunately, none of those challenges are clearly represented in our development agenda, in the MDGs. For example, conflict. Yeah, I've not seen any goal of achieving peace or world peace or African peace in the MDG. The issue of rulership or misrule, they are not very clearly expressed even in the MDGs. You also raised the issue of democracy. Yeah, I know most of the African societies are not very sincerely elective democratic societies. For example, in my local community, or say in my family, yeah, my parents were not elected, and they are very good presidents of my family. my parents were not elected, we didn't vote. But in my immediate community, my traditional chief, we didn't really vote, but we knew the family that would produce the king. And we have fared well. But when it came to this artificial leadership that we have been imposed upon us now, we need to create a new leader for our community. And most times these leaders don't really have the requirement to be able to truly speak in leaders. And then wherever majority supports, and in many occasions, the majority have not always said the right thing. If you look at historical records, most people, when you have group, the majority are always going the wrong way. But here, democracy is based on quantity of people, not quality. Yeah, the vote of a professor and the vote of the man who cannot read and write are treated as equal. Yeah, we know they are human beings, but you know, we are talking about decision that will involve a lot of people, and we are looking at these votes as a. So some of us have struggled with the idea of this democracy we have inherited, and we have been has been forced upon us to implement to whatever point. The issue you raise, what kind of states should be created in Africa? Yeah, it's an area of interest to me. I think the states that have been created now, when we were growing up, we used to hear of Zeke of Africa from the Nigerian perspective, and some other leaders of Kwame Nkrumah, yes. Now, that Africa collapsed, and we have small nation states now. Like we said in the morning, I think that what we need now is a unified state of Africa, where Africa can become a country. And these smaller nation states become like units, province, or whether regions. Because if we continue with the way we are, I'm not sure we are going to meet up any sustainable development of this area. We compare ourselves with United States. United States is 50 countries in one country. We're talking of United Kingdom. So I think maybe within this our discussion, we need to push the AU more. We need to grow beyond this amalgamated AU that we just gather once in a while with Cyrene moving around Ethiopia. We need to grow beyond this and really get to an African Union that can really unify Africa so that we can have a president of Africa. So if a president has done well, for example, in Ghana, he can now move to contest as the president of Africa. So I think the unification of Africa should be one key thing we all need to support. And like you mentioned, even though you didn't explain enough, integrating culture is essential for the development agenda. We have challenges with integration of African culture. For example, language. The French group will push that French must not die. America and someone else to push English must remain. Even in a few nations that speak Portuguese, they will still insist. So how do we integrate? How are we going to do this integration? Finally, you mentioned about global governance institutions as very important institutions. I think that the African Union can also become a mini global governance institution. The African Union, we shouldn't always wait. For instance, our problem is Central African Republic. And the African Union cannot do anything until somewhere, Europe or somebody, has to go there. If there's a problem in Cameroon, there's nothing we can do within Africa until France or France will send its army. I think we, like we said, we have the potentials, but we seem not to believe in ourselves maybe enough. So I do hope that we can look more inwards and really, I strongly believe Africa should become interdependent with America and Europe, not dependent on them. The era of dependence should be over, and we should really seek for interdependence. That's just a little input I think I should make. Thank you.
So Nizo from Nigeria, I just want to add my voice to this discussion. For me, I think Africa has enough human resources. We have enough manpower. I would say that we have all institutional mechanism to develop. But my fear is this. People who make laws, they make rules, they are the same people who violate these laws and rules. And when people in place of authority tell the people they are leading that they have all the powers, they have all the affront to destroy the structure they have put in place, I don't think that such society can go forward. We have weak government. I will say that because when there is no implementation of the rule of law in any society, such society does not develop. You can see, you can attest with me that the reason why corruption is eating deep into some African country is that those who are supposed to check corruption are corrupt themselves. I'm not here to castigate some African countries, and I'm not going to give any name. But if you have been following the trend of economic development of most of African countries, you find out that countries who have enough resources to develop that country, they don't do anything, but they make themselves lord and institutionalize themselves to be richer than that country itself, thereby hindering the development of such countries. So what I'm just trying to drive here is that any type of institution we are going to include in the Millennium Development Agenda without a strong rule of implementation of rule of law, not even just to make, but implementation of rule of law, such agenda, I doubt, will collapse. Taking it back to my own country, you can see that Nigeria have enough human resources. We have enough economic resources. Yet, we have not reached our target. The reason is that there are a lot of interference by government. And this government are politicians who are not thinking better of the people they are ruling, but they are thinking better of themselves alone. If there will be a holistic approach in out of our governance, if there will be sincerity in the use of our natural resources, I think African nation will be a better place. We'll be able to reach our target. I just want to stop there. Thank you very much.
My name is Yaqub Ali from Sudan. Thank you very much for the speaker. It was a really very interesting presentation. But at the same time, it is very disappointing for me with regard to the possibility and prospect of development in future. In your presentation, you have mentioned that education is one of the important mechanisms through which breakthrough could be happen or could be reached. My question is, what type of education you are talking about, quantity or quality education? To make my point clear, or for me, quantity of education is important, but what is more important is quality. What actually needed is education that create changes, education that lead to innovation, education that lead to self-employment, and education that will eradicate poverty and unemployment. Thank you.
So my name is Rui. I came from Gondar. I thank you, the professor, for his excellent presentation. So I came just in the middle of it. But I have one reflection on one of the points that my friend from Nigeria made. This is something that we hear many times. Many people suggest that Africa has to stand as one nation. And that's logically correct. And it would have been better had it been true and had it been real. But in fact, it's most of our intellectuals who are working hard to disintegrate African states from within. So this is just my reflection, you see. If we are commenting on creating one United States of Africa, which would be just simply a dream at this stage, you see, it would be unrealistic because we are having fights everywhere. So let's first deal our homework and then have our, common agenda. Thank you very much.
Well, I guess the comments that came are very pertinent, and I'd be very happy to engage any one of you on this subject. But the main subject that you're all gathered here today is about cultural democracy. Cultural democracy is about equity. Cultural democracy is about acknowledging and understanding not just the views of the majority, but also the views of the minorities. Each individual in a society, each individual in a community, each clan, tribe has a right to survive. This is a God-given privilege that we all have. So when we talk about cultural democracy as opposed to the mainframe democracy where elections and representation become the main issue, in cultural democracy, every human being and every community, every culture has a right to survive. In fact, under globalization, the arena of the globalization of culture and the issue of rights are now creating so much conflict that I'm sure you've read Samuel Huntington on the issue of that conflicts are not going to be because of ideologies, but because of clash of cultures and civilizations. So the point that we need to look into here is, what are the protest movements of the 21st century? what have we inherited from the 20th century. We talk about the United States of Africa, but I don't think we have any institution that's driving it except a bunch of meetings where the African Union leaders talk about it and forget it the next morning. But we have real integration, community integration in Africa. The Somali pastoralists in Ethiopia and the Somali pastoralists in Somalia are the same people, they speak the same language, they have the same religion, they interact with trade, they interact with so many kinds of factors. It's not because we have a border between Somalia and Ethiopia that precludes them. The Turkana in Kenya and the Borana in Ethiopia are the same people. Everywhere you go in African borders, I mean, you have Benin, for example, next to Nigeria, and you have Benin, of course, the state in Nigeria. If Nigeria didn't exist, Benin would never exist as an economic entity. That small country, I remember at one time we were discussing this, what constitutes a border size? Because we were talking about the HIV/AIDS control line between Lagos and Accra. And then so the Nigerian lady said, she's an official, a border crossing is about 30 kilometers on both sides, which means Togo and Benin, you would finish them by the time you go. They wouldn't have any borders, you know. So the point is, you know, this colonial, dissected or bisected borders we have don't represent the social value and cultural background of people. And I think that's where African unification can come. We have to start with what we have already, with what we know already. It's a blend of cultures. If you see languages from north to south, they're blending languages, and of course, they become authentic at a certain point in time. The same thing with cultures. So that's important. The second thing is about education, quality versus quantity. I think we need both. There is no question about it. But the quality of education is important, and the philosophy of education is important. If education cannot lead you to critical thinking, then it's not education. Paulo Freire, in his Pedagogy of the Oppressed, in the Education for Critical Thinking, in his books, that's what transformed Latin America. Even the Catholic theologians joined him in what they called the Marxist theology, which is an oxymoron by itself because Marxism is about atheism, it's about materialism. But the Latin America Catholics came up with revolutionary theology where a human being can only be a human being if he's equal in society. Not simply having the rich and the poor in the same church so that you can tell them that God will solve all your problems tomorrow morning and you have to only have to do is pray. But the point is society has to have an organization which regulates its activities. And in order to regulate that kind of activity, it's important that we have the kind of education for our children to grow up in a community that they understand and know. Not just A, B, C, D, and of course, you learn foreign languages, you learn mathematics. By the time you graduate, you don't have any skills that you can sell into society. We have 2 million Ethiopians in the United States as the diaspora. Some of them fled the criminal acts of the previous governments. Some of them are economic refugees. But these 2 million people can sell their skills to the American economy. We don't have 2 million Ethiopians who can sell their skills to the Ethiopian economy. This is the kind of challenge that we are faced with today. Thank you.